When there is a dull moment, you're thinking, what else should I be doing? What should I be planning ahead?
So we do the final episode, is the bonus episode. Rachel Levitin and Maggie Lee. Thank you so much. We have a tremendous board, and they work tirelessly on behalf of the club, and I'd just like to, on behalf of me and the staff, just thank them for their service. I'd also like to say hello to our new president, Dawn Lisuski. I hope you've had a chance to meet her so far. So far, she's done fantastic work on behalf of the club, settling in terrifically, and we appreciate everything she's doing to hit the ground running. Thank you very much. Now, Dawn and I wanted to be sure to mention as well the very talented Sheena Roteman, who worked tirelessly to put on this event. It's not an easy one to do, and she's done a fantastic job. Thank you very much. On behalf of the board and staff, we appreciate you joining us this evening as we honor the best of journalism in Atlanta. The mission of the Atlanta Press Club is to serve the evolving professional, educational, and social needs of our media community, foster journalistic excellence, and advance the public's interest in and understanding of a free press. Now as ever, our chosen profession is important and a powerful tool for citizens to make decisions about their lives. Here at the Atlanta Press Club, we have embarked on a campaign called Journalism Matters to give attention and a voice to the work we do every day and how it affects our world. So why does journalism matter to me? Because journalism supports an army of trained observers, investigators, and analysts who spend their days illuminating and drawing lines between government, politics, business, culture, aspiration, arrogance, injustice, and even humanity itself. These are lines across a broad spectrum that we as individuals don't always have the resources to draw for ourselves. So journalists do it for us, often at great sacrifice. That is why journalism matters. Now, we want to hear your voices too. During the coming months, we will feature you as members of our local working press, on our social media platforms, and in our broader Journalism Matters campaign. Please take time tonight to see Dawn and give her your thoughts on why journalism matters to you. And we'd love it if you pose for a photo as well. We're going to be using it again on our social media platforms and other marketing for this as we build the initiatives. We want you to join with us to build this movement and show our community the importance of the work we do together. So thank you. Before we celebrate the outstanding work by our journalist nominees during the past year, let's recognize some outstanding students who may be future award winners. To do that tonight is Ken Boskett, the senior editor of Investigations for the Atlanta Journal-Constitution and an integral member of the Atlanta Press Club's Summer Internship Committee. Please say hello to Ken Boskett.
Thank you, Dwayne. As Dwayne said, I'm Ken Foskett. I'm a senior editor for Investigations at the Atlanta Journal-Constitution. And along with Charles Edwards, I co-chair the Press Club's committee that selects our award recipients tonight. And it is my great, great pleasure to do that. This year, we had a very talented pool of 30 students who applied. And we were able to select seven of them to work in newsrooms in Atlanta and in Georgia this summer. And I'd like to call them out and introduce them by name. If you are here, I'm sure I recognize everybody, but please stand and wait till I've called everyone's name. Thank you. All right, Tessa Demare. Is a rising junior at Brown University and will be working at the AJC this summer. Malmi Desai is a rising senior at the University of Georgia and she will be working at Atlanta Magazine this summer. Denver Ellison is yes. Andrew is a graduating senior from the University of Georgia and will be working at the AJC. Colin Hugling is a rising senior at the University of Georgia and he'll be working at the Business Chronicle. Jed May is also a rising senior at the University of Georgia, and he will be working at the Valdosta Daily Times. Fleming Smith is a rising senior at the University of the South in Hawaii, and she'll be working at the AJC. And finally, Grace Walker, a graduating senior from the University of Georgia. She will be working at WAPE this summer. I do have a few words that I would like to say about the program, if you'll indulge me for a moment or two. We were grateful to be able to offer seven positions and seven scholarships to these students, but by my calculation, there were 22 or 23 who didn't get positions, all of whom, I assure you, would have been great additions to any newsroom. What we need is we need more newsrooms to offer a position to a scholar and more money to do that. So if you currently do not, if you're a newsroom and you currently do not sponsor a Atlanta Press Club intern, contact me. I would be happy to talk to you and sing the praises of this program and all the wonderful things that it can do for your newsroom and for these students. If you already offer a position to an Atlanta Press Club intern, consider supplementing their $1,500 summer stipend with some additional money so that they can afford to live in the city of Atlanta while they work for you. And if you're in none of those categories, please contact Dawn and tell her that you would like to contribute money, tax deductible, I'm sure, to this worthwhile program. We spend a lot of time in the news media business these days concerned and worried about the future of our business. And we focus on technology and content management systems and how we can game Facebook. But you know, and I know, that the future of journalism is future journalists. And we need to do everything that we can to support them and find them work and experience that will help them on this awesome journey and this awesome work that we do. So please, do what you can to help. Thank you.
Tim, thank you very much for all of your service to that committee, and I hope you, all of you, will take heed of what he said and look for ways to get more involved and to help us build that program out even further so that we can hold on to those very talented journalists, as Ken so eloquently stated. So before I introduce our master of ceremonies, and we recognize the winners of the Atlanta Press Club Awards of Excellence, I would like to give a special thank you to our partner for this event, the University of Georgia Grady College's James M. Cox, Jr. Institute for Journalism, Innovation, Management, and Leadership. Please welcome Keith Herndon, who is director of the Institute.
Thank you. I'll just give a little explanation. Some of our students are here tonight that are going to be doing these wonderful internships because we're having the Red and Black Banquet in Athens tonight, and they're there getting their awards at the Red and Black Banquet. So, but you know, I just want to say that we're really proud to be a sponsor for this event for the second year. To make sure that our Grady students have the best shot at journalism jobs, whether they're in a traditional newsroom or in a startup loft, means that we have to have close ties to industry. We want your input into the skills needed by our students and how we go about training those skills. The Cox Institute is one of our college's bridges between academia and industry. And I see a lot of familiar faces from my time in industry at the AJC out there in the audience. The Cox Institute has a long history at Grady. We were founded in 1991 by Conrad Fink. Many of you know Conrad, probably had Conrad, worked with Conrad. He is a Grady legend, and we honor his legacy by the work we do at the Cox Institute. Our namesake, James Cox Jr., was the son of the founder of Cox Enterprises and was a media visionary in his own right. Our programs, which include the Grady Mobile News Lab and the Cox Institute Leaders Program and many others, enjoy enormous support from the Grady family, our administrators, our faculty, alumni, and students. Our dean, Charles Davis, is with us tonight, so Charles, say hello to the crowd. And we're also joined tonight by Dr. Janice Hume, who is the chair of the Journalism Department at Grady. We also have a big contingent of students here who are either Cox leaders or Cox Institute Innovation Fellows, done great work. And many of you in the audience claim Grady as your alma mater, so glad you could be with us. The biggest challenge that we face in journalism education is the myth that journalism is dying. For sure, it's morphing and changing and taking new shapes and forms, but journalism isn't dying. The demand for news and information has never been greater, and we must rise to the challenge of ensuring that the publics that we serve can get the news it needs from trustworthy sources. At the Cox Institute, our mantra is that we must stand firmly with unity with those in the profession against those who want to drive a wedge between the work we do and the publics that we serve. Our mantra is also that the First Amendment belongs to no one if it doesn't belong to everyone. The Cox Institute programs are all about embracing change and confronting these challenges. Our goal is to infuse our students with Henry Grady's can-do spirit. We want them to see that journalism can be an optimistic adventure. Optimism is the key word there. Journalists today can't be afraid of change. They must embrace it, live it, make it part of their DNA. And that's why we are excited to be part of this evening as its presenting partner. Because the awards of excellence are examples of journalists rising above our challenges to produce excellent work. We want our students and our communities to see that work and celebrate it. That's what we stand for, and that's what the Atlanta Press Club stands for, and that's why we do the awards of excellence. So thank you for joining us tonight, and let's now get on with the show.
Again, thank you very much for your support. Thank you very much for supporting this awards night, which is so important to us. All right, so let me introduce our master of ceremonies for this evening, Archith Deshadri. Archith is a member of the Atlanta Press Club and spent the last 2 years anchoring a global English news channel in New Delhi. There, he covered the U.S. elections, reported from the White House, and presented his own show, in addition to 4 hours of daily news anchoring. We are thrilled he could honor us with his time tonight, so please give him a warm APC welcome. Archith, thank you.
Nice, warm introductions. Thank you guys so much for having me. My name is Archith. Firstly, let's give a huge round of applause to the Atlanta Press Club for putting together this event. And I know we're all here to recognize and honor journalists, so all the journalists in the room, please stand up. Let's take a look at all of the people who've worked hard over the last year. We're going to give you your credit. All the journalists in the room, please stand up. And a huge round of applause. Wow, what a year it's been. I mean, when I was in India, just to watch the media circus, if you'd like to call it, unfold was interesting. I mean, what a time to be a journalist in the era of fake news and the Me Too movement, and why freedom of the press is so important. And I think that's why our jobs as journalists has always been important, but especially now, when the value of us in society, the value of journalists, continues to be questioned. So, thank you for all that you do, and we are going to celebrate and recognize some outstanding journalists who are sitting in this room right here tonight. We're gonna go a little bit off convention and switch it up a little bit. We're actually gonna present our Impact Award first. So we're gonna hear a little bit about the award, meet the recipient of that, and watch a clip. So our first award for tonight goes to someone who's made a huge and significant impact in the journalism industry. They also abide by the Atlanta Press Club mission and further that mission to make sure there is a free and guaranteed press. Please welcome and congratulate Nydia Tisdale for outstanding achievement for this year's award. And I think we have a great opportunity to thank you for
citizen journalist who was forcibly removed from a political event who was in court today. Nydia Tisdale pleaded not guilty to criminal trespass and obstructing an officer. In 2014, she was arrested by a Dawson County Sheriff's deputy for recording video at a public GOP political rally. Tisdale says that she was bruised and injured when the deputy removed her from that event.
Because it's an assault not only on myself, but on every citizen in our country, for expressing their right of free speech and right of free press. We have to have access to our government and our public officials and our announced candidates.
However, Dawson County says that Tisdale elbowed and kicked a deputy and her removal was not against the law. Even before she was charged, Tisdale said that she planned to file a lawsuit against Nelson County.
And the jury found that I, in fact, did not assault the officer. They believed me, not Captain Tony Hooten. I was found not guilty of obstruction. I did not kick him. I did not elbow him. And they also found me not guilty of criminal trespassing. And my trial, which lasted a week, was in November and December of last year. And my counsel are here with me, Catherine Bernard. You introduced me to Bruce Harvey. And Catherine likewise introduced me to my appellate counsel, Andrew Fleischman. And they have all agreed to represent me pro bono during my legal battle for First Amendment freedoms. And I thank all of you very much. I also want to thank other attorneys who have represented me in the last 3.5 years. Jerry Weber, who is not here, Mike Kaplan, William Finch, and Jeffrey Talley. And I thank all of them because I couldn't have done it without you. Again, my name is Nydia Tisdale, and that's pronounced Nydia rather than however she said it. It rhymes with the name Lydia, and my last name, sounds like tis a season to be jolly, Tisdale. So it's a rather unusual name. I am a citizen journalist, and I video record public meetings of public interest with the digital camera that my husband, Cooper Tisdale, gave to me. And I post them on my YouTube channel. I've got over 1,000 videos on my YouTube channel now, and I've been doing it for about 7 or 8 years. And I really enjoy filming. The first video I ever appeared was in my baptism, my christening. My father filmed me at church, and I likewise filmed his funeral at the same church 50 years later. So it's kind of gone full cycle. And I would like to dedicate this award to my parents, my father and my mother. My father was a retired physics professor at North Carolina State University, and he always had a camera and a video camera, and he documented his 8 children and all of our adventures throughout his life. And my mother passed away on Christmas Day. She was 90 years old. She was from Bogota, Colombia, South America, and she came to this country when there was a rebellion in Bogota called Bogotazo, and her university was burned, and so she could no longer attend school. She had a full-fledged scholarship, but she could no longer go to classes, so she came to this country to continue her education. Didn't speak English, didn't have any finances, really didn't know anyone but the friend who invited her. And she put herself through college in 4 years, and got her degree in microbiology. And when I moved from my home state of North Carolina to Georgia, I took my mother's maiden name as my surname because I had so much admiration for her, for what she achieved and what she accomplished. And when she received her scholarship, she was told that she had done very well on the exam and she was getting notice of the scholarship, and then they didn't receive it from my mother and grandmother. And so my grandmother overheard someone complaining that, well, I paid the Minister of Education so many pesos and we didn't get our scholarship either. So my grandmother actually called the media, alerted them, and there was a huge scandal because the Minister of Education was selling scholarships. And so he was fired and my mother got her scholarship. So I thank the media. It helped my mother get her education. And others that I would also like to thank is Mr. Sam Olens, former Attorney General, who helped rewrite the Sunshine Law. And I would like to show the Red Book, which is a Georgia Citizen's Guide to Open Government. Sunshine Law consists of the Open Meetings Act and the Open Records Act. And that, of course, I don't have to tell you and all of that. Everyone knows that. But Holly Mannheimer and Jerry Weber gave me this book a few years ago, and that's when I learned that I could attend public meetings and I could film them with my camera. And we have that right. Anyone has that right. We also have the right to obtain public records. They're called public records because they belong to the public. They are our records. So I just want to thank the Atlanta Press Club for this amazing award tonight. It's nice to know that some of you have watched my videos and that that you're aware of my struggle and my fight for our collective First Amendment freedoms. And thank you to my husband for being in my corner and for supporting me through all this. I appreciate it.
Thank you again. Congratulations to Nydia. Let's continue with the other awards for tonight. So here's how it's going to work. We're going to read a quick little brief bio about the nomination. The winner, let me announce, we'll congratulate them with a plaque. There'll be an opportunity to take a picture, and at the very end, we'll take an award picture with all the award recipients. All right, so for this year's Atlanta Press Club Awards, this is how everything sort of played out. The judges looked at a variety of different things, including the quality of the content, how impactful it was to society, and the demonstrated reportable ability. Journalists who either worked for an Atlanta publication, digital, broadcast, new media, print, or had covered a story in Atlanta were eligible. That being said, the first category for tonight are print and online for a daily publication. The finalists are Moni Basu, CNN Digital, nominated for storytelling, showing a dedication to the telling a story of the people whose lives are difficult and inspiring and often unnoticed by the world, including a girl called Noor from Iraq. She suffered a severe spinal birth defect and was saved by American soldiers and doctors 11 years later. Our next nominee, Thomas Lake, CNN Digital. Thomas is nominated for his work in setting out to learn why police officers shoot, why they hold their fire, and how it feels to make such a momentous, monumental decision. His reporting led to a three-part series called The Trigger and the Choice, published in August of last year, 3 years after Michael Brown's death in Ferguson, Missouri. Our next finalist is Jessica Ravitz, CNN Digital. Jessica is nominated for a coverage of Paulette Leapheart, a double mastectomy cancer survivor who walked topless from Mississippi to Washington to raise awareness for breast cancer. And Holly Ann is our final nominee for this category. She's also from CNN. She's nominated for her work covering Kentucky's potential to become the first state in the nation with zero abortion clinics, and also telling the stories of those in the front lines of the abortion debate. The winner of the Atlanta Press Club Award of Excellence for Print and Online for a Daily Publication is Thomas Lake with CNN Digital. I would like all the award winners to say a few words. It doesn't have to be long, just something to thank and tell us about their story.
Okay. I'd like to thank my colleagues at CNN, especially the editor-in-chief, Meredith Artley, who took a chance on me and gave me a job 3 years ago. Jan Winburn, the wonderful editor for this project. Steve Goldberg and Kathy Strait for being such great bosses. And finally, my friend John Blake for reading the story and giving me some excellent feedback. Thank you all very much.
And just to point out, we will be posting all of tonight's winning work, including Thomas's, right after this event. And once the winner has been announced, you are allowed to tweet, Facebook, Instagram, Snapchat, whatever you'd like to. Our next award of excellence is for print and online reporting with a non-daily organization. The finalists are Max Lau, freelance for his work in recent years covering the epidemic of addiction in the United States. Jessica Knoll and Rebecca Lindstrom from WXIA for their coverage of a 200-mile stretch of I-85 from Georgia's northern tip of South Carolina, through which 30 bodies have been found. And our last finalist is the digital reporting and production teams of the Weather Channel for the ambitious undertaking to tell a story, but tell the stories about climate change, and for every state in the nation to use every tool at their disposal, including creating documentaries, features, maps, and even a nonfiction comic book. The winner for the print and online for non-daily goes to the Weather Channel's digital reporting site. Move on to our next category. This is for documentary or series reporting. The finalists are Jeremy Campbell, Aaron Gutierrez, Matt Livingston, Lauren Ruzio, Lasavage from WXIA. This for their coverage of a triangle-shaped geographic region just north of the city of Atlanta, including wealthy suburbs like Alpharetta, Roswell, and Johns Creek, that represents an overwhelming number of heroin overdoses in the state of Georgia, including a nearly 4,000% increase since 2015. Next, also from WXIA, Brendan Keith, for a series of multiple investigative stories undercovering the national crisis of innocent people being arrested for driving under the influence of marijuana due to the so-called drug recognition expert and the training that leads good officers to make bad arrests. While they're on a roll, the next finalist is also from WXIA, Jennifer Leslie, Stephen Boise, Mike Jensen, and Jessica Knoll for tackling the topic of suicide by talking with survivors, family members, friends, and experts. No guesses for the next finalist, also from WXIA. Matt Pearl and Lauren Ruzio for examining the leadership of President Donald Trump in a way that's not done enough through the voices and perspectives of the people he serves. And the last finalist, not from WXI, it's from Atlanta Journal-Constitution, the AJC, John Spink and Ryan Horn, for their joint effort in telling the stories of Atlanta Squad 4, a team of firefighters specializing in hazardous materials, and how John has covered Metro Atlanta first responders in action for more than 3 decades. And the winner of the Award of Excellence for Documentary and Series Reporting is, it's actually a tie. Jeremy Campbell, Aaron Gutierrez, Matt Livingston, Lauren Brutziel, and Bliss Savage with WXIA, and Brendan Keith with WXIA.
Incredible piece of work about helping people who are dealing with thoughts of suicide. Brendan Keith, who is also a co-winner with us but not here tonight, exposed a policy that was, you know, having people charged with driving under the influence when they hadn't had anything to drink. All of these pieces have made a profound impact, not only on the way we tell stories, but also on our communities as a whole, and we're really grateful to be able to be a part of an organization that allows us to cover these kinds of stories in depth and try and make a difference for the people that we cover, because that's what journalism is really all about. So thank you.
All right, we move on to our next category. It is the Award of Excellence in Radio Reporting. Finalists are Johnny Kaufman, WAVE 90.1, for his story covering the special election in Georgia's 6th Congressional District and the Boost campaign spending gig for local TV stations. Olivia Rheingold, GPB, for her story detailing the big business of methadone clinics in Northwest Georgia. John Powers, GPB, for a story on how the U.S. Department of Veteran Affairs recently expanded its 24-hour call center service with a second hotline in Atlanta. Stephanie Stokes, 90.1, WABE, for covering the City of Atlanta's consideration of a crackdown on urban dirt bike groups. And Ellie Yu, WABE, for telling the story of the Georgia disability advocates and their concerns over the Medicaid cuts in the GOP health plan. And the winner is? Also a tie. Sean Powers with GPB and LEU with WAB 90.1. Now to television reporting. The finalists are Meredith Edwards and Diane Gallagher from CNN for their story featuring a previously homeless state championship winning quarterback and the coach that took him in. Rebecca Lindstrom and David Brooks from WXIA for their investigation of whether or not Georgia enforces a federal law requiring those convicted in domestic violence charges to surrender any firearms to authorities. Misty Turnbull, WSB, for her coverage of the infamous I-85 fire and bridge collapse. And the winners are Rebecca Lindstrom and David Brooks from WXIA.
Going on socially, legislatively, and just trying to figure out what makes sense and what doesn't. I know there's been a lot of effort to try to look at gun violence as it relates to domestic violence. It's really gained no traction in the legislature, but that as journalists shouldn't stop us from talking about it and so many other important issues that we're covering each and every day. So for just persistence and continuing on the subject and being at a station that supports me in all that I do. Thank you, Jennifer, Julie, and my direct boss, Jeff Reed, for allowing me to do.
Our next category for tonight is videography. The finalists are Justin Crate from WSB for his work uncovering information about the effects of concussion on children. Erica Hernandez with the AJC for her coverage of an unusual occurrence, two churches, one black and one white, getting together to talk about race. Matt Livingston, WXIA, for his body of work as a DOP Director of Photography, Atticus, WXIA's Digital Investigative Unit. And Kate Parker, Marissa Venegas, and Mike Ellis with the Weather Channel, and Inside Climate News, for their investigation of how care studies, policy drafts, and political donations industry groups turn many Ohio lawmakers into renewable energy skeptics. And the winner for this category, Kate Parker, Marissa Venegas, Mike Ellis, and Kate Parker.
Talking a minute ago about the 50 states of climate change. And if our goal here in Atlanta is for 100% renewable energy, this very much pertains to us. There is a playbook, and that playbook is to go to the states and to go even smaller than that, grassroots, small communities, and destroy the efforts for renewable energy. That is our future in Atlanta. That's something that we will face. So, local journalists, pay attention. There's a playbook out there. It's playing out in North Carolina and Michigan and Ohio and absolutely here in Georgia as well. I have to say a big thanks to Mike Ellis, who was our videographer on this, because he is a Georgia boy. I've spent a lot of time in the Midwest, and so the first time that he set eyes on that golden hour of the Ohio cornfields, we had to physically restrain him in the car before he wanted to get out and shoot every second of it, because it really was just beautiful. We had a gorgeous team, they were beautiful, but a great team, gorgeous scenery, and of course our leadership. This would not happen without them. This is not a cheap or easy endeavor to tell these stories, so thank you for letting us to continue telling them.
All right, our next category for tonight, the finalists for the use of sound. We have Oscar Carrillo with WSB for incorporating natural sound of gunfire and horses being affected in a story about a local woman who is fighting against a shooting range near a horse farm in North Georgia. Our next finalist is Emily Curtin with Georgia Public Broadcasting for the audio she brought back from covering a recent practice of the little-known sport of underwater hockey. Myself. Our last finalist is Stephanie Stokes with 90.1 FM for the sound she used in her coverage of the City of Atlanta's consideration of a crackdown on urban dirt bike groups. All right, and the winner is Oscar Carrillo with WSB. Congratulations.
For me, personally, sound is one of those things as a photographer that I love. I grew up in New Orleans, so I was always tied to music. It taught me a lot about editing and cadence and editing the story, and that's so important. And this story, and I had done one similar to it, it's about ski shooting, as we were telling you about. A guy opened a ski shooting range in Forsyth County in this really quiet, mountainous area up there, so wherever you would go, you could hear the ski shooting from miles away. So the folks were upset about the tranquility being disturbed by the ski shooting. But sound, if I go out and tell a story, we talk about this a lot. If we don't have sound, we really don't have a story. Sound is so important because it's sort of that glue that brings the story together. And the challenge for me on this story that is there was sound all over. Guns, boom, boom, boom. But if, like music, it's got to be subtle. And I think you just got to bring, it brings the person, you kind of put them there by putting the sound and parking it correctly. And I think I did a pretty good job doing that. But it was a challenge. It's sort of like editing two stories in one. There is video, there were a little, I kind of smiled at it, but over 400 edits in that story, video and audio. And there were more audio edits than video. And that's, when you sound correctly, I think it makes a very powerful story. You don't need crying all the time. I think sometimes the ambient sound says so much more. Thank you to all the other recipients in that category, because I think sound's a cool thing.
Sounds good, right? Sounds right. Good. All right, the award for excellence for single image photo finalists are Curtis Compton, the AJC, for getting an image of the Georgia Dome collapsing in ashy heat while its gleaming replacement stands in relief. Stephen Fowler, GPB, for a photo he captured when violence broke out on the campus of Georgia Tech during a vigil held after a student of the LGBTQ community was fatally shot and killed by police. John Spink, the Atlanta Journal-Constitution, AJC, for his news photos consisting of breaking news with compelling subject matter and visual impact. And the winner is John Spink with the Atlanta Journal-Constitution. Julie Domansky and Nicole Bonacorso with the Weather Channel for a series of photo essays documenting the vast differences of the rebuilding after floods hit Louisiana. Tim Freesia, Nicole Bonacorso, and Kevin Hayes, also with the Weather Channel, for their documentation of the famine that has gripped Somaliland and to provide insight on how this would help with their independence relief efforts and how it's hindering it. And lastly, also from the Weather Channel, Alex Roblowski for his documentation of traveling to Puerto Rico after Hurricane Maria made landfall and the weeks it followed, and the many issues, including the shortages faced by the victims on the island. All right, so the winner is somebody from the Weather Channel. It is Alex Roblowski. Congratulations.
He reached out to us, and over in the span of a week, we got a ton of coverage covering hospitals and the power outages. And even a few weeks ago, they were still like not even 100% with power. So to be recognized for this, that's amazing. I want to thank my editor Kevin and Neil and Greg for helping us or encouraging us to keep doing things that are really significant to us. Thank you.
The next award is for investigative reporting. Finalists are Brenda Goodman, Andy Miller, Eric Hensley, and Elizabeth Knight. WebMD George Pelton News for their investigation of how closely cities in Georgia were following lead testing results and rules in the aftermath of the Flint, Michigan water crisis. Next, we have Alan Judd, the AJC, for his investigation into the Savannah College of Art and Design and its iconic leader, Paula Wallace. Carrie Teagarden and Sheila Cole with the AJC for their investigation into the role of physicians in creating and spreading the epidemic of opioid addiction. And the winners are Brenda Goodman, Andy Miller, Archie Henry, and Elizabeth.
Flint, Michigan, we're all aware of what happened there, and when this idea came to us, actually from the Blind Foundation, and a board member of ours suggested this, we said, okay, well, this is not going to be like Flint here in Georgia, but we were astonished at how little cities and public water utilities were testing water in high-risk homes, which they should have been, and they just weren't doing it. And so we had great, Brenda was terrific, and WebMD and Erica and Elizabeth were great, and we came across cities where they were testing gas stations and empty lots, right, in Demarest, and it's still out there. I mean, lead is still a problem. It's not just Flint, and it really damages kids' health, and this is something we continue need to follow up on, but this was a great partnership between WebMD and Erica and Elizabeth, and Grady too, that's right. So thank you very much, appreciate it.
All right, we have three awards left for the night. So our final three awards. The next one is the Award of Excellence for Rising Star. Finalists are Evelyn Andrews, reporter of newspapers, for her continued coverage to keep Buckhead leaders honest on a wide-ranging master plan for Buckhead's commercial core. Aaron Bauer, around the rings for his coverage of the 2016 Olympic Games held in Brazil, which continued well after the games were done, holding organizers accountable for a legacy of failure. And Kiara Frisby with CNN Georgia News Lab, at 24 years old, she's already produced an impressive body of investigative work with news organizations around the state and country and earn an array of honors and awards. And the winner is Kira Frisbee. And Kira. Second to last one is the one for reporting on civil and human rights. The finalists are John Blake, CNN Digital, for his continued passion and professionalism in handling the coverage of race in the United States. Leah Dunn with WSB for her reporting on a word-of-mouth seller financing scheme that was targeting low-income African-American communities in Metro Atlanta. And the last finalist, Danny Robbins with the AJC for his reporting on healthcare in the Georgia prison system. And the winner is Leah Dunn with WSB.
Hi everyone, I'm not Leah Dunn. I'm just honored enough to be her news director. She and the investigative team is absolutely fabulous, and this story was actually a collaboration not only in Atlanta, but in several of our Cox Media Group stations across the country. And it really, you know, shined the light on how these folks were being targeted, and they were being sold homes in sort of a rent-to-own scheme that they didn't really understand at the time. And so as soon as they missed a payment, they were out. And it was very sad, and several of us got together, our station in Tulsa, Jacksonville, and some other cities across the country, tracked this guy down in Dallas, and he had some answering to do. And so we got a lot of answers from him as well. So great job to Leah, great job to our investigative team. Very proud of them as always.
All right, and the last award for tonight, the News Innovation Award, is in partnership with the Cox Institute for Journalism Innovation, Management, and Leadership. The finalists are Max Blau, freelance reporter on the opioid crisis and the fact that it will continue to get worse before it gets better, and his research on innovative ways in which he can hope to bend that curve. Jeremy Campbell, Aaron Gutierrez, Matt Livingston, Lauren Rootseal, and Bliss Savage with WXIA. They're named after a character in To Kill a Mockingbird. This digital investigation team focuses on stories that can be difficult to talk about with a digital-first approach, producing documentary series-style coverage based on important issues headlines. And Nick Valencia with CNN for his innovative coverage of a donut shop in Rockport, Texas, serving customers after a Category 4 Hurricane Harvey made a direct hit on the historical coastal town. All right, and the winner for this award, any guesses? All right, they've swept so many awards already. WXIA, Jeremy Campbell, Aaron Gutierrez, Matt Livingston,
doesn't look at you like you have six heads when you say that is kind of what innovation is all about. We are so lucky at WXIA and at TEGNA to be supported by a company and an organization that not only prioritizes innovation, but allows us to try all kinds of crazy things. Our team and our unit really gets that ability to spread our wings and to make TV and news and journalism that not only is important to our communities, but stuff that people actually want to watch. And being able to have that freedom and that opportunity has been amazing for us and a real gift in order to tell stories that matter. So thank you.
All right, so congratulations to all the nominees, the finalists, the winners of the Atlanta Press Club's Awards of Excellence. We certainly appreciate your dedication to reporting the news and to journalism. And once again, we also want to thank the Cox Institute for Journalism, Innovation, Management, and Leadership for partnering with the Atlanta Press Club on this event. And also, really quickly, just to let everybody know, we might have mentioned this at the beginning, we may have forgotten, but just to make sure everybody knows, the judging panel was not based out of Atlanta. These were submitted to a panel with the Alaska Press Club, the National Press Club, and IRE, so they probably had no idea who you were, which now they don't. Before we wrap up for tonight, we get all the winners to please come up on the front of the stage so we can recognize you once again and take a group picture. Thank you so much. Again, my name is Archis. I really enjoy being here. See you next time.
Take the photo.
Yeah, so we got some really great shots to reach.